get free of the mind. Say your body talk to me nice. Say now my love you didn't need for your life. Yeah, I love to be like. Say yeah, we did together, yeah, day and night.
I'm live on Facebook.
Yeah, if you leave, I'm stroking your mind, baby. Loving your body, baby, as you're
whining.
Welcome, YP, BAB, and Youth Link family. We are the Urban League Twin Cities Young Professionals. This is our general body meeting for the month of October 2021. We are an unapologetic and relentless advocates for equity, justice, and power for African American descendants. We intend to be an organization with standards of excellence in serving the community, developing leaders, and creating social network for young professionals that will build powerful relationships. We are a chapter of the National Urban League Young Professionals. Our chapter is a part of a network of young professionals from across the country who provide leadership development, economic empowerment, and community volunteer opportunities for other young professionals and community members. The YP movement creates training opportunities while developing and educating young professionals to take leadership roles within the National Urban League, the Civil Rights Movement, and society at large. Bridging intergenerational gaps in leadership, an intergenerational workshop series in which we invite industry leaders that come from the environmental circumstances similar to the demographics we serve into a space we share, where we share our lived experiences, challenges, and triumphs navigating corporate and industrial America. These workshops take many forms in our latest rendition. The Black Army Brigade has added the existing partnership with Urban League, Twin Cities Young Professionals, and Youth Link's Voices of Youth Advisory Council. We have invited four brilliant, Black, and bold women to spend an hour with, participating in an interactive conversation with our youth and young professionals as part of the ULTCYP general body meeting. Traditionally, the series is curated to be informative, and there is an interactive tool that you may take away to empower you in the given focus of the program, to-do list. power mapping, researching, and development tools. For this segment of the Bridging Gap series, we are building from our latest conversation about competitive funding strategies, where Deanna Cummings sat in power with us to provide insight into grant writing 101. We will attempt to connect the relevance between grants and scholarships while also providing a few gems with you to take away to enhance your chances to score. We ask that you check in with us by dropping your name, business, contact information. If you have a website, drop that in the one check in the comments in the chat box. And then if you have questions that come up while the presentation is happening, we encourage you to use the raised hand feature down on your toolbar, and one of our committee chairs will help you elevate your voice. A.M. McMillan Porter, she is knowledgeable, persuasive, professional with a bachelor's arts in human resources, training, and counseling. She has worked with the University of St. Thomas for some time with the College of Education, Leadership, and Counseling. She is the Assistant Director of Community Engagement and Recruiting for the School of Education. She previously worked with the Mayo Graduate School of Medicine as the Director of Minority Recruitment. She has additional certifications in diversity and equity training, grant writing, and further professional development. We are so excited to have you with us here tonight to discuss the many ways to get our education paid for with free money. Find ways to leverage our specialized disciplines to further empower us here tonight and watching that in the virtual land when they come across these tools you will share with us tonight. Truly bridging the gaps. Let's give a YP welcome to Ms. Aya McMillan Porter.
Thank you so much for having me. So I'm sharing my screen. I hope, can everybody see that?
Yes, we can see it.
Oh, good. Okay. Well, this presentation is called Preparing a Scholarship Kit. And one of the reasons I started doing this is I realized, well, for myself, my parents had five kids. They were in the military, put aside a little bit of money for each of us, and that wasn't enough to do a whole lot. And I was very fortunate in that I was able to go to college. I kind of fudged a little bit on my what you see. I actually have three bachelor's degrees. I'm not that smart. I just kept changing my mind and changing my major. And then I went back to school and got a master's degree. But I was able to graduate in 4 years with 3 degrees and zero debt. Now, to be fair, I stayed home. I lived with my parents because I could live there for free. But I basically got scholarships and grants. And the nice thing about it, as Joy said, that's free money. So much better than student loans. And so for myself, I realized that the best way to take advantage of this is to prepare ahead of time what I call a scholarship kit. And that way, when you find out about opportunities, it's easier to apply if you have things kind of sort of ready and together. So let's go. There we go. So one of the things that I recommend as you find your scholarships, review them and organize them by deadlines, because some scholarships you'll have a very short window in which time in which to apply. Other ones that you may discover, someone may send your way, you have a longer time. So you don't want to miss out on opportunities because you missed the deadline. So I recommend as you find them, review them, organize them by deadlines. It's very important that you use the form that they require. Sometimes scholarships, they will have a form that you fill out. Sometimes they just tell you, just send your information. Whatever the instruction is, please follow them, because you don't want to do all that work and then you don't have an opportunity to be awarded the money because you didn't follow the rules. So it's really important that you use the manner of submission they require. If they tell you to send everything together, send everything together. If they tell you, there are still some, believe it or not, that want hard copy. If they want it snail mail, send it snail mail. If they say you can send it virtually or, you know, by electronically, do that. But the biggest key is you have to follow the directions. Another thing I want folks to consider is to prepare your brand. That is a marketing marketing vocabulary. But you have to remember that if whatever it is, whether you're going for a scholarship, whether you're interviewing for a job, whether you are interviewing for school, that you're trying to sell something. You're trying to sell you. And so that's what you have to keep in mind, whether it's a face-to-face, whether it's virtual, whether it's based on the essay that you write, a personal essay, you are trying to tell them why you are terrific and why you are the one they should choose. So think about that very carefully. I recommend that everybody practice an elevator speech. Okay, I'm old and that terminology is even before my time. But in this sales games, people used to have to do what they called cold calls. You wouldn't have an appointment. You would just go to people's office and see if you could just grab a few minutes of their time to tell them about your product. And so they would tell you to practice about a 5 to 10 minute intro, that in case the only opportunity you had was you were able to get in the elevator with somebody and you only had the length of the elevator ride to intrigue them enough to want to talk to you more, that's what they call an elevator speech. Well, a lot of times if you're interviewing for a job, if you are interviewing for a scholarship or what have you, you need to be able to figure out what are the high points, what are the most important things I need to make sure I tell you about myself. And because we all get nervous, okay, don't tell anybody, I stink at interviews. You probably already guess I'm a talker and I can go off on a okay, like that. Anyway, so if you only have a few minutes, you want to make sure you hit the important things. And that's why you practice. But you want to practice in a way that doesn't make you sound rehearsed, but just that you've been thoughtful. So think of 5 things that you want to make sure that you tell them about you that make you unique and wonderful and why you should be their choice. And think about things and ways that you can be memorable, but you want to be memorable in a good way. So do things like if you're going in for an interview, please don't have discussions in the lobby that you wouldn't want your mother to hear. Now I'm gonna tell you, when I interview people and I sit on job searches, I sit on admissions boards and things like that, don't tell on me. A lot of times I go sit in the lobby because a lot of people don't even take the time to look at the website. And for whatever reason, they put my picture on the website. And so they don't know that I'm the person they're interviewing with. I can't tell you some of the conversations I have heard in the lobby. And then you can only imagine their face when the time comes and I stand up and go, "Hi, I'm Mrs. Porter. I think you're here to meet me." And they think back to what they were talking about. Not good. So you want to be memorable, but in a good way. One of the things you will find very, very common in scholarship applications is that you have to write an essay. So what I recommend is that you have essays already written and have about 250 words. Some will be that small. Most are probably around 500. A lot of essays for scholarships or even for admissions aren't real long because somebody got to read those. And usually it's a committee and it's like, after a while, things start to blur. So for their own sake too, they won't make them really, really long. But if you already have in your computer saved a couple of essays that are on the most common topics that they usually request on scholarships, then even if you hear about it and you've got an opportunity and you only have 2 days to get stuff together, you're already ahead of the game. I've listed here some of the most common topics for leadership. For essays. Number one is leadership. Tell me about your leadership skills and how, why you are a leader or ways in which you're a leader. Another one is they want to know your goals. Another big one is overcoming obstacles. And that can be a good one if, like, for example, let's say there is a scholarship, there's a GPA requirement, and yours is just about like on the bottom part of that. Or I have people all the time who ask me, because I work with graduate students here at St. Thomas, and they go, I want to apply for graduate school, but I might not have been the most committed student as an undergrad. And I tell them the same thing I tell my kid, the same mantra my parents used to tell my sisters and myself. When you mess up, you fess up, you straighten up, and tell them what you learned from the experience. Because that way we know you won't make that mistake again. So in talking about overcoming obstacles, if there's some bugaboos, that might be something you choose, because that tells them how thoughtful you are. Now, I mean, nothing too outrageous, but that might be an obstacle you may choose to share based on the appropriate venue. Like I said, if your GPA isn't quite as stellar as you know you could be, you might want to talk about that. And talk about things like, well, like one guy told me, he said he didn't go right to college after high school. He went into the service, served 8 years, and got married and had a child. And so by the time he wanted to use his GI bills to go to college, he said he got his undergraduate degree. And he was a husband, a parent. He was working full time and going to school full time. So he said, you know, his mantra while he was doing his undergraduate was, a C will get me a degree, which will get me a job. But that's not truly who he is, and doesn't show the scope of what he could have been. But he goes on to explain, you know, I was 26, 27 when I started school. I was working full time and I was a husband and had a baby. That's why I focused on just doing what I needed to do. So again, overcoming obstacles. And another one is a description of someone you admire and why. So again, you're ready to go. Some of the places to search for scholarships. If you have a job, check with your employer. A lot of businesses have scholarships that they either offer to their employees or maybe to the dependents of the employees. So ask your parents too, if they know of something. Now, some things did get cut back with COVID and after 2008 with it, but a lot of things are being offered again. And so it doesn't hurt to ask it at your job. Matter of fact, there's a commercial now where Amazon is hiring, and there's a young brother that says, it'd be nice if you pay for my tuition, like all of it, Amazon does. So if you have a job, ask if they have any kind of tuition reimbursement. Unions, some of the unions like the Teamsters and what have you, they are the Pipefitters 101, Teachers Union. A lot of unions also offer scholarships either to their members or the family members of their members. It doesn't hurt to ask. Student organizations, I recommend you check not only the local, but regional, state, and national offices for student organizations. Things like emerging educators, or just anything that, any kind of, Black student unions and things like that. Because again, they have, a lot of them have, and even if it's not a huge amount of money, it's free money. And a lot of it goes unclaimed. So you might as well be the one to claim it. Religious organizations, a lot of more and more churches, synagogues, mosques and stuff have asked for money for scholarships so they can support their faith members. Again, it doesn't hurt to ask. Organizations have utilities companies, banks, credit unions. Like I made my kid. I have one kid who's a student at Mac, McAllister. But the credit union that I belong to said that they had scholarships for members. So I told my kid, you got to take your $5, go open an account at the credit union so you can apply for that scholarship. Sometimes Minneapolis or some of the cities have scholarships for people who live in that city. So again, you have to put yourself out there and ask. Fraternities and sororities. A lot of fraternities and sororities have annual fundraisers where they have scholarships. And you don't necessarily have to be a member of the fraternity or organization in order to get the scholarship. My husband is a Sigma, Phi Beta Sigma. And about, I don't know, 7 or 8 years ago, there was a big to-do in the Black Greek community because the Sigmas are pride themselves on having scholarship money to give away every single year. And a number of years ago, they ask you to write an essay. And people were appalled because the person who won the scholarship that year was a white woman. They go, what? The Sigmas gave money to a white woman? Well, because they put the word out to all their undergraduate chapters and the high schools and everybody. They got two essays were submitted. And it was just a blind reading and they picked the one that was best and turned out that was, I don't know how she found out about it, but nowhere in the application did it say you had to be either male or Black or a member of the fraternity. There are a lot of places that do scholarships like for Martin Luther King Day or things like that. And again, just find out if you qualify, what the qualifications are and apply for it. Professional organizations. I'm a member of the Minnesota chapter of the Association of Black Women in Higher Education. And we often have scholarship monies that we give away. And now for us, we do say you have to be a woman. Don't necessarily say you have to be Black. So check with them. Nonprofits may have scholarships. The biggest key is you have to be diligent in your looking, but also tell people that, you know, I'm really looking for some scholarship money. And other people might have ideas of places that you could apply or information. The colleges and universities themselves look for institutional scholarships and grants. The federal government awards a lot of money in grants. The state governments, you can, if you go on the state of Minnesota website, you can find that there are scholarships and grants for residents. Local organizations, companies, social organizations, check with businesses, the Chamber of Commerce. True story, there was a gentleman who used to work here in our facilities area who retired. And he'd been retired like, I think, 2 years. And he just called me one day and he said, isn't Z, my kid, isn't Z graduating from high school this spring? I said, yes, he is. And he said, well, I'm gonna be downtown. I'm gonna drop you off an application because he said, you know, I'm a member of the Italian American Club and the Italian American Club has scholarships. I said, Harry, you know, I know there's a lot of stuff in my background, but I don't think any of it's Italian. He said, you don't have to be Italian. Like, are you sure? He said, sure. And God bless, like I said, he had been retired 2 years. He drove downtown to give me this application so my kid could apply. And so I took it home and I said, Mr. Harry brought you the, and see, are we Italian? I said, no, we're not. But Mr. Harry said, we don't have to be. And Z applied. And Z has reapplied and they have given my kid money every year. It's $1,500. They give $750 for the fall semester, $750 for the spring semester. And don't you know that covers books? So you never know, but you got to put the word out there. I listed some companies down here at the bottom. All of those companies give scholarships. So you could just do like a general Google search that says companies that give scholarships and these will come up. And again, just, you know, follow the directions. A couple of things, again, like I said, look for everything. Another true story. Again, I think I took five kids, I'm two, three decided that when she was going to college, that she wanted to go to the American College in Paris. And my parents said, hey, look, you know, we saved a little bit of money for everybody. You get the same amount as the two older ones. And I don't know if that's going to get you to Paris. You're going to have to figure out to get to Paris yourself. Now, this was in the olden days, again, because I'm old, where everybody didn't have, you know, the internet and stuff. But there used to be a big book at the library, at the public library, that was about this thick, that listed all these scholarships. So one Saturday, my sister went to the library and she was looking for all the scholarships that she thought she could qualify for. One of the scholarships she found had been set up in 1953 by a couple whose son had gone into the Marine Corps and had died in battle in Korea. And so they set up this scholarship in their son's name and said, if you were either a Marine going to college or you were the child of a Marine, if you wrote your essay, if they selected you, they'd send you $500. So since both of our parents are Marines, my mother was a sharpshooter in the Marine Corps. Not only did she wear Army boots, that woman could take you out at 1,000 yards in a headwind, but okay, I digress again. But truly, it's a whole new meaning to your life when your mom says, I brought you in, I take you out, and you know she could do it. But anyway, because both our parents were Marines, she wrote her little essay and sent it in. And 6 weeks later, she gets a response and a check from these folks for $5,000. This money had been sitting there for 35 years. She was the first person to have ever applied for it. And they were so excited, instead of $500, they gave her $5,000. Now, I'm not saying everybody will do that, but again, instead of $500, they gave her $5,000. She went to the American College in Paris. She got sent home after the first semester, and the CIA was involved, but that's another story. You can ask me later about that. But again, all these companies have scholarships as well. Now, I listed some of these scholarship search sites. There are also places that tell you if you send them money, they will search for you. Save your money and search your own self. There's too much out there and too much information that's available for free. And you can bet, if you look at the ones that I've listed here, if you send somebody, I think one place was like $50, and they say, tell me a little bit about yourself, you're going to see the exact same ones that I have listed. They're going to list, and I'm listing them for free. Don't send anybody your $50. There's also, there was one, Sholly, S-C-H-O-L-L-Y. That one, that was actually listed on Shark Tank. And it was a guy who was got accepted at Harvard, I believe. And he started looking for scholarships because his parents didn't have a lot of money, and he got an academic scholarship, but it didn't cover everything. And so he found so many scholarships for himself, he decided to make this search engine to look for scholarships. He ended up selling it on Shark Tank. So it used to be free, but now they charge. But I don't think they charge a whole lot, especially if you are still a student and have an EDU in your email address, but don't quote me on that. But FastWeb, WebEx, Peterson's, the College Board, Niche, scholarships.com, collegenet.com, the scholarshipsystem.com, Unigos, the studentloanhero.com, all of these, you can find scholarships. I also recommend checking with the college financial aid offices, because they may have unadvertised scholarships. Like when I first came here to St. Thomas, I worked specifically with the graduate psychology department. And I was just looking through something, and I saw that, I don't know if anybody here would remember, there used to be a number of stores called Applebaum's in the metro area. And Robert Applebaum owned like 15 stores. He sold them to the Rainbow chain, if you remember the Rainbow stores. So there was one in the Midway, there was one uptown, there was one in North Minneapolis, Robbinsdale.
On Broadway? One on Broadway.
One on Broadway, yes. And so I guess when he made millions by selling these Applebaum grocery stores to the Rainbow company. And I guess when he died, I don't know if he never married or had children, but he had no heirs. So I was reading something, because I always look for things, and he left this money, he left his estate in trust at the First Bank of St. Paul. And they had set it up so it would be what they called loan for scholarships. The way it worked is if they gave you the money and you finished your program, it was a scholarship. If they gave you the money and you did not finish your program, then it was a loan and they wanted their money back. And they were focusing on people in healthcare. And they had a name and number and they said, but don't call. So I called them. Well, I figured if I wasn't asking for myself, it was okay to be a pest. And so I got a hold of this, the person who was managing the estate funds. And I said, well, this says healthcare. I said, I'm specifically looking for scholarships that someone who is going into the mental health care field could possibly qualify for. And she said, well, I think the only people we've ever had apply for money have been either nurses or going to med school. She said, we have a board meeting in 2 days. Would you be willing to come and do a presentation for our board? I said, sure will. I'll beg from anybody. So I went. And you got to be bold. And again, I wasn't asking for myself. And so I went and said, you know, I told them, you know, we need more mental health professionals. There's not enough. It's a shortage area. They said, okay. So the St. Thomas students and every year since then, they've let given money to 6 St. Thomas graduate students, 3 master students, 3 doctoral students. You don't ask, you don't get. So again, and then what I did is I had to let our financial aid office go, no, I said, there's going to be people applying for this. They're going, what is this? So now they tell me, if whenever you find a new scholarship, tell us in the financial aid office, because people will come in and ask about it and we won't know because you just sent the information to people to apply. So that's why I said sometimes your financial aid offices may have unadvertised scholarships because they're small or just for one area. College departments may have scholarships or have information about scholarships that are offered to people that are in that academic discipline. Like we've had people who have, you know, left money for a teaching fellow or whatever. So ask about that as well. Please, please, please apply for any scholarship, even and especially the smaller ones, because there's less competition for the smaller ones. Everybody wants to apply for the big ones, but then there's 10,000 people you're competing with, and free money is free money. Again, like I said, the Italian American Club, I don't know, they give out about 20, 30 scholarships a year, but $1,500 is $1,500 and paid for my kids' books, and I'm not shelling out that money. And those little ones can add up. Talk to your parents, your family members, your friends, because they may have information about scholarships for which you can apply. And network, network, network. You got to talk to people. There's no shame in saying, hey, you know, I'm trying to keep my student loan debt down and I'm looking for scholarships. There is no shame in that. It just shows that you are thoughtful, careful, smart, frugal. Well, that's enough. Shows that you're careful with your money and everybody else's too. Couple of things I do have to mention though. Again, as more and more things are online and applications are online and the information about scholarships are online, it's really, really important that you protect your online identity. So if at all possible, please avoid discussions or examples of things like drinking or drugs, homophobia, xenophobia, racism, sexism, violence, because more and more people are searching. When they get their finalists, they're looking people up. And your online identity can negatively affect not only admission to school, scholarships, or even hiring decisions. I mean, even an old person like myself, I had an opening for a student worker and for, you know, St. Thomas students. And so I had a number apply. I saw some really good cover letters. And I had notified, I think, 8 people that they were being invited in for an interview. So then I went online and looked up those 8 people. One of the guys that I had invited for an interview, every single Facebook picture had him with a can of beer. Every single one. And I thought, ooh, I should have looked him up before I sent that invitation for an interview. I don't know if I really want to hire somebody who might have a little issue. And even if he doesn't drink on the job, I don't want to deal with hangovers or whatever. But I'd already invited him for the interview. So he came in and he was smart. He was serious. And so I asked him, I said, okay, I have to ask. Because I said, I looked everybody up. I almost contacted you to take back the to rescind my invitation for an interview because of all the alcohol. He said, what alcohol? I said, every Facebook picture has you with a can of beer. He said, oh, Mrs. Porter, I don't drink. I'm a Quaker. Well, why do you have all those pictures of you with beer cans? He said, because, you know, my fraternity brothers and my roommate, they think it's funny because everybody knows I don't drink. Like, I didn't know you didn't drink. And I almost didn't want to come. And I ended up hiring him and he worked for me for 2 years. And then that rat left me for a full-time job with benefits. Some people have no loyalty. But again, he almost lost out on this opportunity because I thought he was a drinker. So again, and like I said, I'm old. So you know newer people are looking folks up. Just as an example, here's some of the online hazards that you may or may not have heard about. In 2016, former Mississippi offensive tackle, Laramie Tunsil, everybody thought he was going to be not just in the top five, they thought he was going to be the number one draft pick in the NFL that season. But about 2 weeks, I think, before the draft pick, somebody leaked a picture of him smoking on a bong. He dropped from number one, or even out of the top five to the 13th slot. He did get drafted, but that cost him millions of dollars in salary. And once the word went out about it, he lost his endorsement offer from Gatorade, from Nike, from Adidas, because nobody wanted a pothead to represent them. So that cost him a bunch of money. In 2017, there were 10 students who were admitted to Harvard. And they had their admissions rescinded after posting racial messages on social media. It's real, folks. It's real. People are looking you up. 2019, Penn State, Duke, and Southern Methodist University dropped prospects after reviewing their social media accounts. And Duke even went on their website and said, we had to rescind some offers. And says, just so students know, your social media pages say a lot about your character, discipline, and common sense. And I don't know why they call it common sense, because it's like common courtesy. Sometimes it ain't too common. But basically, they said, we don't want you representing us. So you have to think about that. Some additional help that I offer, and I love this blog. Too bad I don't get any endorsements money from them. But it's called JLV College Counseling. And the reason I like it is because they offer free, it's free, and they offer a lot of information about a lot of topics, such as, okay, your college application checklist, or the financial advice, and how to better understand that financial package when they're offering you, because you might think that they're paying for everything, but if you don't know what to look for, you may not realize that everything's not going to be covered in that financial aid package. They talk about decision day checklist. They have articles for freshmen and how to adjust to being away from home and why do you need to maintain a good sleep program. They even have stuff for parents. Like, okay, my husband's a professor here at St. Thomas. Again, we have the one kid. When Z was going to college or applying for school, they had two that they couldn't make up their mind, and it got to be decision day. So we sent deposits to both schools. I didn't realize until later when I read the blog that that's a no-no. First of all, if you tell them, never mind, my kid's not going, they won't give you the money back. But also, if they find out that you have sent deposits to more than one school, you could lose all of your admissions offers, because if you're sending a deposit to a school that you're not sure you want to go to, that means somebody who does have that on their top of their list, they don't get an opportunity to come because they're still on the wait list. So they explain stuff like that. So this is really helpful to either people who are applying to colleges who are first generation, or people who are like sixth generation, but got parents who've been so long since they've done it, they don't remember how to do it, like my husband and me. But if you sign up, it's like I said, it's JLV, as in Victor, collegecounseling.com. If you go on the, you can go on the website at any time, and at the top of the box, you can pick scholarships and look at the scholarships. But if you sign up, it's free. And every single Saturday, they will send you a list of scholarships. Every single Saturday. And the reason I like that is, like I said, you can go look at it anytime, and they have them split out in categories. So like for graduate students, or based by race, or based by gender, or based by major, based by age, you know. But when they send out that list every Saturday, they start off with a bunch of what is called just do them scholarships. There's like five different organizations now that I know of for sure, that if you sign a pledge not to text and drive, they will put your money in the hat. And if they pick your name out of the hat, they send you $1,000. Just for signing, just do it. Just for signing the pledge not to text and drive. My kid doesn't drive, and most of their friends don't drive. I said, you and all your little knothead friends should be applying for those every single Saturday. There's one that if you do a little video on your phone about distracted driving, they put your name in the hat, and if they pick you, they send you $1,000. So most of them don't have any kind of age limitations or anything. So they're just do it. They're quick little things that you do one thing, and they put your name in the hat, and if they pick you, you'll get money. And again, so it's like, it's something, just those just do it are things that you could take a half an hour every Saturday and just do that. And who knows, they just might pick you and send you money, free money. I know sometimes people might be looking, maybe not for money for school, but maybe money for something that's important to you, or it might be you're looking for a grant. And that's why I included in here information. There's the Grantsmanship Center, Minnesota Grant Watch, and the Philanthropy Digest. They send out emails weekly with information on grants. I just this summer, because I have some, like I said, I have some things that I'm doing here that, because of cutbacks, things that are programs that used to be funded by the university that aren't being funded anymore. And because I'm so invested in these programs, I have the support of the university to continue with the programs if I find funding somewhere else. So this summer, I took a series of grant writing workshops. I can't remember what they cost. I think it was like $150, but they're really involved, because grant writing's no joke, y'all. They talk about how do you have a budget and how to tell them, you know, what it is you want to do and, you know, what you hope to accomplish and how to do this. And but I learned a lot, and I've submitted my first grant. So keep your fingers crossed for me. But again, you can kind of, some people might be better at this than I, and may feel they don't need the class, but I recommend if you want to write grants, it can be very helpful. There's also, I know sometimes people have already been to school, maybe want to go back to school, but have student loans. And they're like, okay, what do I do with that? And keep your eyes out. Again, talk to people and ask, keep your eyes out, because that's part of that package that President Biden is trying to pass, has student loan forgiveness money in there. But there are other opportunities to get student loan forgiveness also. So like there's public service loan forgiveness. That's a federal program that supports teachers, nurses, firefighters, and other people who are serving their communities. So you can check the website ed.gov/news, or it's also listed under studenta.gov/PSLF waiver, because that stands for public service loan forgiveness. And if you fall into one of those categories, they may forgive some of your student loans if you already have them. If you're a teacher, there's a teacher loan forgiveness program. And basically they say, if you've been teaching for 5 years, a lot of times they want you teaching in an area where a certain percentage of the children qualify for free or reduced lunch. But teachers may be eligible for forgiveness on loans. So again, under that studentaid.gov in This one, you do a backslash teach forgive, and you'll have find information there. There's a Minnesota Healthcare Loan Forgiveness Programs. And those are set up for either rural or urban mental health professionals, rural or urban physicians, and psychiatric nurse practitioners. And you can find that under health.state.minnesota.us. So those are some of those where if you're in, if you have your practice in what they consider an underserved area, if there are not enough healthcare providers in your area, they and you have student loans, they will pay back some of your student loans if you have your practice set up in an area where they don't think there's enough. And it doesn't necessarily mean you have to move to Leroy, Minnesota, because sometimes, I haven't checked for a while, but I know for mental health professionals for a long time, Invergrove Heights was considered an underrepresented area for mental health professionals, because they said most of the people who are mental health professionals had their practice either in Minneapolis or St. Paul, and the people would have to travel, which may impede their ability to get services or something like that. So if anybody's in that field, or if you know somebody in that field, tell them to check that out too. So that's it. I know I'm a fast talker, but the biggest thing is never, ever stop searching and spread the word so other people know that you, so if they find something, they will tell you. And best of luck.
That was awesome. Deep gratitude.
I know I talk a lot.
No, you dropped a lot of gems, and you know, we're appreciative of that. I do know that there was a couple questions that came up. And one was about actually building scholarships and, like, you know, being a young professionals group, if we wanted to. Oh, hold on, let me take you off the spotlight so they could see us all. Saying that, you know, being a group of young professionals and things, if we wanted to build upon the cooperative economics and of our history, how would we be able to build like a fund that, you know, we can offer then scholarships?
Well, I think I would definitely get somebody who understands finances to help you out, because like when you're writing for grants, one of the things they ask you is, okay, how much money are you going to need in this grant to cover like administrative costs? And what other kind of costs do you need to cover? Because you want as much money as possible to go for the program participants as possible and not to pay a whole bunch of people who aren't, you know, doing this necessarily. You also, a lot of times they recommend for new scholarships that you're either going to have to raise money, do fundraising every single year, and you probably will anyway, but you also want to make sure that you have a certain percentage of the scholarship money set aside that you don't touch, so it has an opportunity to gain interest and help grow. Because if at all possible, you don't want to take your funds down to nothing at every time. So sometimes they recommend that you at least have the money sit for 5 years before you start dispersing the money. But someone who understands finances and how to make the money last as long as possible, if you don't have dedicated fundraisers and a plan in place to raise funds every year, you don't want it to be one and done, if at all possible. Does that make sense?
Yeah, it does. Thank you. I'm opening the floor for any of our YPs to elevate any voices that they might have came across on our social media platforms, or if you yourself have any comments, reflections, or thoughts about any of the information that we received.
I know that went fast. There's so many, there's scholarships out there for left-handed people.
Seriously?
Yes. There was a bunch of scholarships for tall people. I think men had to be over 6'2", I think, and women had to be over 6 feet, I think, in order to qualify as a tall person. But I mean, there is so much money out there that goes unclaimed. And that's why I think, like I said, you search for scholarships. And like I said, all those companies that I listed, if you could go online, just do a Google search right now for corporations that give scholarships, and you a list will come up.
I just wanted to thank you for being here with us. This is awesome. And I completely feel you on, I'm a talker too, but I do need like a schedule, just because I can, once I'm passionate, once I'm talking, I can rant off. It'll be good information, but you'll be with me for a couple hours. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I have to hold myself back too, but I honestly really appreciate all this. I actually just shared this video with a couple of my cousins who are on their college shirts right now. And I would have loved to have the JLV website when I was looking for scholarships. And so I sent that over right away and was like, get signed up for this, share it with them the Saturday, the Just Do It ones. But I think this information is awesome because it first off, it's a tool that we can share with a lot of young people who we know have a hard time looking for scholarships or different money for school. I know when I was looking, I would go to the websites that everyone would know about, and there would be like 10,000 submissions for a scholarship. So really honing in on looking at the smaller businesses, but I'm gonna ask my company too, because I wonder if we give out scholarships for some of the young people in our organization. And so I think this was really amazing. I also, do you know who Bill Woodson is?
Oh, yes, I do.
I was in a case study program at St. Thomas when I was in high school, and yes. Woodson led that program, and I met Miss Woodson. I don't
know. Oh, Francis is the best, yes.
A powerhouse, like, so I just wanted to make that connection too. But yeah, I appreciate you. You're amazing. Yeah. This is awesome.
And I will get out of your hair, but I'm on the Minneapolis campus, right downtown Minneapolis. And I put my email address in there. If people have other questions and what is it? I don't typically send stuff out, but if you can contact me, if you come to my messy office, I'm happy to spend more time if people need some more time or more information and are willing to come downtown.
We did have one more. About the how grants and scholarships kind of favor each other, but then how they differ. They're asking if you could speak a little bit to like the relevance between like, you know, those short essays mm-hmm. that you prepare and how those could also be used in a way like for both grants and scholarships.
Sure. Scholarships often are for a specific school. A lot of times they may be for a specific discipline. Like there's, you know, scholarships just for people who want to be accountants and things like that. A lot of times with scholarships, they have a GPA requirement because they don't want to send money if they don't think you're going to make it or what have you. And a lot of times, some scholarships have specifics saying that it can only be used for tuition. Some scholarships say we will only send the money to the school for you. And then that way they know they take whatever tuition is owed off the top. And then if there's something left over, you get it. Some scholarships, they'll send the money right to you. But a lot of times scholarships have GPA requirements or minimums. Grants tend to be more focused toward maybe they want just to encourage people in an industry, or they just want to, some of these companies just want to give money back. The biggest thing I think to remember about the essays, both for scholarships and grants, if they want you to write an essay, this is an opportunity to introduce yourself to them, to whoever's making the decision. And it's a way for them to know something about you that is above and beyond what your GPA might be or where you live or what your name is or anything. And so you want to tell them something about you, whether even if you're talking about leadership, maybe telling your own leadership abilities or how you would like to improve your leadership abilities or overcoming, whatever it is, you want to tell them something that makes you stand out and memorable. And like I said, it's okay if you made mistakes, if you've learned from the mistake. You don't want to say, oh, well, you know, that's just the way it is. But an essay is a word picture of you. That's something else. Sometimes they will ask for a picture. Please send something nice. I got a picture for one of these guys. Yeah, don't send pictures like that. send something that makes you look like you're sending it to church or something, you know, send something that says, yes, I'm a serious person and I seriously want this and I will do good things if you entrust me with your money. Did that make sense?
Yeah, it did. Definitely.
And there's a lot of companies that give money because they know they make a lot and it makes them look good to the board of directors and investors and stuff that says they invest in the communities that support them. So let them support you.
For sure, for sure. You'll get that free money. Any final comments, thoughts, or reflections from anyone on the call or in Facebook land? No. Well, thank you, Ms. Porter, for spending this powerful hour with us, educating us and putting us on game when it comes to funding our education.
Yes.
There are a lot of gems that were dropped. And for those who registered, you would get this PowerPoint that also has the clickable links in your follow-up email. Be on the lookout for that from our Secretary or Membership Chair. And then if you're from the Black Army Brigade, I'll also be sending that out to you as well and YouthLink participants as well.
Feel free to contact me. Now you have to remind me how we met or even if it was, we were on the call together or whatever, because I'm old and I get 100 emails a day. So I may not remember, but I will answer. So feel free to contact me if there's anything I can help you with.
For sure, for sure. So that concludes our workshop portion of our general body meeting and thus our Facebook Live as well. Thank you all for joining us this evening. We ask that if you are on Zoom, you stick around to be able to learn a little bit about the Urban League Twin Cities Young Professionals and some of the committee reports. And at this time, deuces, Facebook.